Again, that's Luke chapter 20, verses 1 through 19. Please follow along with me as I start this one. One day as Jesus was teaching the people in the temple and preaching the gospel, the chief priests and scribes with the elders came up to him and said, "Tell us by what authority you do these things, and who is it that gave you this authority?" He answered them, "I will also ask you a question. Now tell me, was the baptism of John from heaven or from man?" And they discussed it with one another, saying, "If we say from heaven, he will say, 'Why did you not believe him?' But if you say from man, all the people will stone us to death, for they are convinced that John was a prophet." So they answered that they didn't know where it came from. And Jesus said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things." And he began to tell the people this parable. A man planted a vineyard and let it out to tenants who went into another country for a long while. When the time came, he sent a servant to the tenants so that they would give him some of the fruit of the vineyard. But the tenants beat him and sent him away empty-handed. And he sent another servant, but they also beat and treated him shamefully and sent him away empty-handed. And he sent yet a third. This one also they wounded and cast out. Then the owner of the vineyard said, "What shall I do? I will send my beloved son. Perhaps they will respect him." But when the tenants saw him, they said to themselves, "This is the heir. Let us kill him, so that the inheritance may be ours." And they threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. What then will occur to the owner of the vineyard to do to them? They will come and destroy those tenants and give the vineyard to others. When they heard this, they said, "Surely not." But he looked directly at them and said, "What then is it that is written? 'The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. And everyone who falls on that stone will be broken into pieces. And when it falls on anyone, it will crush him.' The scribes and chief priests sought to lay hands on him at that very hour, for they perceived that he had told that this parable against them. But they feared the people."
Who has authority over you? Who has authority over you? Who has say in your life when they say jump, you say how high? Who has authority over you? Who can tell you what to do? My wife. No. The big group wedding, you ever see that when they say, the husband is the head of the household, and then the wife goes, "Yes, but the wife is the neck." That's hilarious. Who has authority over you? We don't like the word authority. We don't like the word submission. Who do we submit to? Because we're Americans, right? Like individual freedom. Like, you can't tell me what to do. Particularly because we're human. You can't tell me what to do. Most of the world believes that life and real freedom is found in autonomy. A self-directed life is the good life, is one where you can choose what is good for you based on how you think or how you feel, and that will lead to joy and freedom and purpose and life itself. The more autonomous I am, the more self-directed I am, the more alive I am, the more free I am. I can do what I want when it comes to my money. I can do what I want when it comes to my vote. I can do what I want when it comes to my sexuality. I can do what I want when it comes to my relationships. The more free I am, the more alive I am. You can't tell me what to do. Christian freedom, Christian life, is defined, however, not through a plurality of choices, being able to choose whatever I desire, but to a purpose. Christian freedom is teleological. which just simply means that whatever something is created for in their nature, the more they live into that, the more free they are, the more alive they are. Let me give a couple examples. A hammer, if you use a hammer as a hammer, it enjoys being a hammer. If you use it as a screwdriver, it doesn't enjoy its kind of purpose of what it was made for. A fish that decides, I want to live outside of water, will die. They're not more free. They're not more alive because they chose in discord with their nature. Actually, they're now dead. A violin, right? You take a violin and you play it, and the more you use it as a violin, the more music comes, the more joy comes, the more free it is living and enjoying being who it is as a violin. If you use it as a hammer, just because it chooses to be a hammer means death, destruction, disaster. The Christian life, our purpose is to glorify God, to enjoy Him, to find ourselves in relationship, in submission to, in worship of our God. This is what you were made for. This is what I was made for. And the more I live into, the more you live into your purpose, the more free, the more alive you will be. So I'll ask that first question again. Who has authority over you? He tells us where we find life. He tells us how to live in relationship, in submission to our God, the living God, we find life. So like in this passage, we'll see an argument, a lot of tension. And now, I would hope you're having a lot of arguments with the living God, and He is winning them all. I think it's fitting that we, before we get into the text, we're just simply going to walk through the text together and then pull out a principle or so of how this applies and changes our lives at the end. I think it's particularly fitting this morning that we would kneel before our King who is mighty and merciful. If you're able, if you're willing, would you kneel with me now and ask God to speak to you through His scriptures? First, would you praise Him for who He is? Maybe you have seen His character, particularly this past week, in a good blessing He's shown you, or in the way He's been present with you in suffering. Would you praise Him for who He is silently now? Now would you ask Him to speak to you this morning in His scriptures, through His word, that you would enjoy the joy of a relationship with Him in a new way this morning. You would find different pieces of your life in submission to Him in new ways this morning. That you would see Him more clearly and hand yourself more fully to Him. Ask Him to speak to you this morning. Father, thank You for who You are. You're just amazing. You pour blessings on our lives that we don't deserve. You never leave us in our unfaithfulness or in our suffering. You carry us, You reshape us, You draw us to Yourself. You have made us sons and daughters by grace if we're trusting in You. This morning, would You speak to each one of us for Your purposes? Would You open up Your word to us in a way that would be impactful and transforming? Will we submit more of our lives to You? In this submission, in this worship, there is great joy. And you are worthy of our praise and of every piece of our lives. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Okay, here's the text. This is an argument with Jesus where they are questioning Jesus' authority. Should we submit to this one, they are asking. Chapter 20, verse 1, we'll just go through the interaction in history. This is the last week of Jesus' life. He has turned his face towards Jerusalem in chapter 9 of Luke, and then the rest of the book of the Gospel of Luke is heading into Jerusalem. Then we have found Jesus now in Jerusalem, the last week of his life. He's cleansed the temple. He's wept over Jerusalem. And now the scribes, the chief priests, the elders confront Jesus because what we know is true of this group in verse 47 of the previous chapter, that they are seeking to destroy Jesus. Verse 1, one day as Jesus was teaching the people in the temple and preaching the gospel, the chief priests and the scribes with elders came up and said to Jesus, "Tell us by what authority you do these things, or who it is that gave you this authority." Jesus is teaching. He's teaching in the temple like he often does, and he's preaching the gospel, the good news. And this teaching, this preaching, it's otherworldly. It's very different than the scribes, the elders, the priests are used to. It's actually in stark contrast to their teachings, to their way of life, the way they have structured all of their living. Jesus is preaching the gospel, right? Just think of this message in contrast to our world's message, right? The good news of the gospel is that a right relationship with the living God, a right relationship with others, it's not based on earning or how good you are or what you do. Actually, it's not based on you or me at all. You can never be good enough to be loved by God on your own. Your rebellion, my rebellion, is so infinitely great that there's this massive chasm between us and our God, our Father and our King, our just and mighty, holy God and Father and King, and us. There's such a chasm that nothing could be done. But the good news, the preaching of the gospel that Jesus is doing says, it's been gifted to you. That Jesus lives a perfect life. Absolutely perfect from start to finish. Never thinks a sinful thought. Never does a sinful thing. Never retracts and doesn't do the things he ought to do. He's always perfect. Unlike you and unlike me. And then he finds himself on purpose hanging on a cross, taking the penalty for your sin and my sin. And then he resurrects and he says, take it as your own. All you need to do is have faith to trust in who Jesus is and what he's done. This is the gospel, the good news. And it's such a stark contrast. It's not based on what you do or I do or how good or bad you've been in your life. It is simply based on Christ and what he has done. And the good news is you're accepted no matter how wretched you are. That is just cataclysmically different than the system that the scribes and the system that you and I often live in. Which is to say, you have to earn your way into relationship with each other, be good enough to be loved. And you have to earn your way to God, be good enough to be loved. Jesus says, no, it's otherworldly. And then all of his teachings, or all of our teachings, man, they hit us from all these different angles. Otherworldly stuff. He says, with your money. Don't hoard all your money for college and retirement. Give it away. What? Your enemy who treats you poorly. Don't seek vengeance or hold a grudge. Forgive them and pray for them. What? Don't look lustfully at a woman. Even that is adultery. He says, save your sexuality for marriage and that covenant relationship of and nowhere else. And we say, what? The gospel itself, all of Jesus' teachings are thrown right in the face of all the way we live and the way they were living. At the core of Jesus' teaching, his preaching, is this idea of this is about him, his truth, his authority, telling you and me how to live. And what will lead to life and flourishing if we would place ourselves under his authority. But they do like we do, and they say, tell us by what authority you do these things. Who is it that gave you this authority to tell me what to do? You don't have say in our lives. You're not king of my life. He is shattering their systems. He's transforming their whole paradigm for living. And they say, do you have that kind of authority in my life? He's going to flip everything upside down for them if they would submit to him. By what authority do you do these things, they ask. I love Jesus then answers. He answered them, I will also ask you a question. You get the moment, they're like, hey, tell us how you have this authority. And Jesus says, I'll tell you what I want to tell you. I'm going to ask you a question. So he takes the reins, as Jesus often does, because he's the Son of God. He's God himself. And he asks them a question. Now tell me, was the baptism of John, that's John the Baptist, from heaven or from man? And so here's the kind of sum of that question. Jesus says to the scribes, the elders, the Pharisees, they're testing his authority. He says, was John the Baptist, was his baptism, what he is doing here, right? He's a contemporary of Jesus. Was his baptism from God or from man? Was it good? Was it godly? Or was it from man and shouldn't be trusted, right? Like, should we do what John the Baptist said to do or not, right? Is it from God or is it from man? And John the Baptist, here's what he's doing. He's saying, repent, you're all sinful people. And then John the Baptist is saying, and follow Jesus because he's the Savior who's come. He will forgive your sins if you trust in him. He's the one I'm not even worthy to bow down and untie his sandals on. So John the Baptist is saying, you better follow Jesus or you're toast. So Jesus asks them a question. He says, so John the Baptist, was he saying what is right or what is wrong? And notice their response. They discussed it with one another, saying, oh, shoot. That's in the Greek. Oh, shoot. If we say it's from heaven, this is good, John the Baptist's teaching is good, then Jesus will say, well, why do you not believe in them? Why are you not submitting to me, Jesus? If his teaching, if his baptism is from heaven, why would you not submit yourself then to Christ? But if we say it's from man, then all the people will stone us to death. For they are convinced that John was a prophet. Man, he's popular, everyone's following him, and if we say his teaching was wrong, oh, dang, we're toast with that too, because then they're going to stone us. So they answered Jesus that they did not know where it came from. They're trying to discern, well, what is true, right? What is true of John the Baptist and his teaching? Who or what has authority in my life? And this is how the world goes about finding what is true and what has authority or who has authority in their lives. Which is first just, hey, let's discuss this. Some self-assessment. What do I think when it comes to what's true or untrue or who has authority or who doesn't? What do I feel is right or wrong? What teaching ought to I follow or not? Let's figure this out. What do I think? Self-directed. It's then also shaped by common opinion or the masses, right? Like, oh, let's take a stock of what other people think, right? What do they think? What do they think? And then, okay, in this cultural moment, in this context, what do I think is true? What do I think is right based on what they say or they say? And then, oh gosh, it's truth is very practical then, right? Like it weighs the consequences too. Like if we say this, oh man, then that'll happen in my life. If I say that, then oh man, that'll happen in my life. So do we see a truth without Christ as king simply says, what do I think is right or wrong? What do they think is right or wrong? And oh shoot, what consequences will this bring? So they're stuck having to say, we don't know. We don't know. And Jesus responds, well, then neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things. If he had a mic, he would just kind of drop it. Then I won't tell you by what authority I do these things, a.k.a. I have authority over you. I'll do what I please when I want, when I want. I'll say what I want, when I want. If you say, ask me a question, I'll answer you with a question. I'll do as I please. I'm God himself, Jesus says. What's the right answer, right? Well, John the Baptist's teaching is from God. But they can't say that. Because if they say what is true, what is right, they'll have to submit themselves to Christ who stands right before them. That's the right answer. See, the Christian paradigm is to say, we get our truth, we get what is right from God himself through Jesus and his word, the teachings of Christ, the teachings of the church in his scripture. We trust him alone. He is our king and our savior. See, Jesus from the beginning of his life came to dethrone you. Jesus came to dethrone us. One of my favorite details, right, when Jesus is born is in Matthew chapter 2. From beginning to end of his life, Jesus is dethroning you, dethroning me, because he is king, and also in submission to him, there's found life and joy and freedom truly. Jesus is born. This is Matthew chapter 2. Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king. Herod is ruling over Judea, and behold, wise men, they come from the east to Jerusalem, and here's the question they ask Herod the king. Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose, and we've come to worship him. Worship who? The true king. When Herod the king heard this, he's troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And he assembles all the chief priests and scribes and people. Why? Because he has to go kill this king who is born. And see, the king hears the real king is born, and he is troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. They are shaking. Why? Because there can only be one king. You or me or the real king, Jesus. Submission to him for eternal salvation. Submission to him for daily life and living. Life is found in submission to our King, the one true authority. So now I want to step back and say, okay, well, where are you in conflict with Jesus? You know, where are you in conflict with Jesus? Coming to him saying, do you really have authority over that piece of my life? Or maybe you're asking, do you really have authority over my whole life? Where are you in conflict with Jesus today? And then I kind of want to ask, well, why would you give your life in submission to the King Jesus? So where are you in conflict, and then why would you submit? So first, where are you in conflict? In premarital counseling, we've gotten to do a whole bunch of weddings, and it's one of the joys is to do premarital counseling. And in premarital counseling, we'll have our conflict and communication. We always do that one as a second session after the purpose of marriage. And so we'll start that, and we'll say, so what are you guys arguing about these days? You know, what are you arguing about? What are you having conflict over? And then this one couple, this one time goes, we don't argue. We just don't argue. And what I wanted to say at first is, well, you just wait. Courtney is assertive, aggressive. I am assertive, aggressive. That was in our kind of personality test. So our premarital counselor said, "You're gonna have lots of fights." Sorry. But this one couple says, "Well, we don't argue." And I literally did say in that moment, I said, "Well, then you two don't know each other, and you're not unified together, because you're a sinner and you're a sinner." And you have a different direction in life and a different upbringing than you have. You have a different direction, a different upbringing, different ideas of how life will go. So if you're not arguing, you're not unified. If you're not having real conflict and then working through it to come to unity and submission to each other, then you're not in this the tight-knit unity of relationship that you were created for. Or you're not even heading towards it. You're just kind of two separate people living two separate ways of lives. And smiling a lot. What's so beautiful about this moment is the scribes, the Pharisees, the chief priests, they're coming before Jesus and they're saying, "We've got a problem with you." It's a real opportunity for them to then say, "And we submit to you." We could have real relationship where you become our king and we find life following you. It's a moment of conflict that can come to a moment of unity where there'd be such deep joy in obedience and following and embracing the king. So I guess I'd say in your own life with Jesus, do you have conflict with him? If you and I, who are sinners, are being united with the Holy One, God himself, in relationship with him, there ought to be some conflict, and you ought to be losing, and I ought to be losing. If you're not having conflict with God, the Holy God, then probably you're living in this direction in life, and he's living in that direction in life. You may not even know him if there's no conflict in your life with the living God. Certainly you've not said, "I submit my life to you. I want to live every piece for you." If there's no conflict. Or maybe, though, there is conflict. Maybe there's conflict in your life with Jesus. And instead of kind of saying, "Okay, I want to seek what you say in this area of my life," instead of that, you're saying, "Man, when it comes to raising my kids, I'm going to figure it out on my own. I'm going to ask the experts. I'm going to ask some friends. And I'm going to decide what it looks like to raise my kids. When it comes to singleness, I'm going to look at my life as a single. I'm going to say, well, what do I want to do with my time and my resources? I'm going to do things my way. When it comes to marriage, I'm going to just figure it out. When it comes to my money, when it comes to any aspect of who I am," what you're saying when there's conflict with the living God, you're saying, "I'm going to figure out how to do it my own way." Rather than searching the scriptures, rather than submitting to his teaching, rather than trusting him, following him as your authority. Or maybe you are having conflict in a certain area of your life, and now you're seeking him and saying, "What does it look like to be faithful to you in this area, Jesus? What does it look like in the scriptures to pursue you and follow you, Jesus, and trust you? What does it look like when I ask other believers within the church and they help guide me towards what it looks like to follow and submit to Jesus? What does it look like when I pray and say, 'Lord, I want to submit to you. Would you guide me in the next steps of submission?'" And in that you will find life, when you are seeking and following and submitting to your King and your Savior. In your money, your relationships, in your work, in every piece of your life. It's taking the moral, the ethical choices and saying, "I want to conform to your will, Father." It's taking the maze of your life, even in the suffering, and saying, "I don't fully understand this, but I want to embrace you in it and follow you in it still." Well, why would you do this? Why would you, why would I submit every piece of our lives to our King who is Jesus? And Jesus began to tell the people this parable as an answer to that very question. He began to tell the people this parable. A man planted a vineyard and let it out to tenants and went into another country for a long while. There's an owner of a vineyard. He's the one with authority. He owns it all. He's we could call him, in a sense, the creator, the king, right? He's the owner of this vineyard, and he lends it out to some tenants who can kind of live in the vineyard while he's away for a long while. When the time came, he, the owner, sent a servant to the tenants. Think of this as the prophets. Obviously, you can see the different characters of the parable up here on the slide, right? We've got God, the owner. Then we've got tenants who are the people of the world, in a sense, who are here to steward God's creation and his earth, or your job, or your place in your family, right? You're a steward of his. I'm a steward of his. And he sends servants, these are the prophets, to talk to the tenants. And here's what they say, so that they would give him some of the fruit. I love that request, by the way. The owner sends these servants to just get just a little bit of the fruit. Just some of the fruit of his own vineyard. But the tenants beat him and sent him away empty-handed. As they did over and over to the prophet, saying, you said to live life for you in this way. You said to trust the Savior to come, but no. All the way to John the Baptist. And he sent another servant, but they also beat and treated him shamefully and sent him away empty-handed. And he sent yet a third. This one they also wounded and cast out. How patient is this owner? How kind is this owner? He's mighty. He owns the whole vineyard, and he slowly sends one, two, three servants for just a little bit of his own fruit. This one they also wounded and cast out. The owner of the vineyard said, what shall I do? And you can almost sense the mercy, the compassion welling up in him, yet still he says, I will send my beloved son. Notice the adjective, his beloved son, the one he loves. Perhaps they will respect him. But when the tenants saw him, they said to themselves, this is the heir, let's kill him so that the inheritance may be ours. And indeed, through his death, it would become ours who would trust in him. And they threw the beloved son out of the vineyard and killed him. What then will the owner of the vineyard do to them? You can see the scribes and the Pharisees and the chief priests at this moment saying, oh, dang. And Jesus answers, he will come and destroy those tenants and give the vineyard to others who would faithfully submit to the Son and trust in him. When they heard this, they said, get this, surely not. Oh, my gosh. They probably said, oh, my God. In fear and trepidation, knowing a just God would crush them for the way they are treating his beloved son, and they had treated all the prophets and the messengers of the owner of the vineyard in years previous. Jesus looked directly at them. Jesus looks directly at them and said, what then is this that is written? The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Psalm 118, but Jesus' own words saying, I am the beloved son, Jesus is saying, come sent to the Father's vineyard to bring you grace and truth, the good news, the gospel teaching that is bringing, and the way to live that leads to life in submission to him. And the more we find ourselves in constrained to him, under him, submitting to him, the more free we become, the more alive we become. But you rejected him. The chief cornerstone, everyone who falls on that stone will be broken to pieces, and when it falls on anyone, it will crush him. And maybe you know how a cornerstone works. It's the largest stone laid in Jesus' time. At the corner of a building, it sticks out outside of the two supporting walls. Then two walls are built up on it, and so you can be on the outside and stumble on it and fall. Right? And that's bad, but then Jesus says, but that of the biggest and the heaviest and the most massive of stones, Jesus is equating to himself. You might stumble on him and trip and fall, but man, if you reject his mercy and the grace of God, that stone, that mighty stone, will crush you. So I ask this, why would we submit every piece of our lives to our King and our Savior. Why? Because he's a mighty King, but he's a merciful Savior. He's a mighty King, right? He's the owner who has it all. He's the one who says he will bring destruction, right? And he looks directly at those he is speaking to. He calls himself the cornerstone, this most massive and mighty of stones. Yet at the same time, he's a merciful Savior, right? One, two, three, pleading for you. Would you just trust him in that area, even that area? And when you stumble, when you fall again, he says, there's mercy still in the Son who is crushed in your place. You don't need to be crushed. See, that's the kind of King who is our Savior. We would say, I trust you. I love you. I want to follow you with every piece of my life. Why would I not trust that King, that Savior? He is our cornerstone. He is our King. He is the one who our whole lives are built on. So you and I, we need to choose our King yet again this morning. He's a trustworthy King who's so merciful and also so mighty. If we reject his mercy, we will be crushed under his just judgment. Yet his mercy, his grace is open to us over and over again, and even to you and even to me. From start to finish, Jesus came to dethrone us for our own good, and to be worshipped as the mighty, merciful King and Savior that he is. From that moment he was born and King Herod said, oh my, another king is born, to the moment Jesus steps towards the cross as our King and Savior. As we prepare for communion now, I'm going to read a longer part of text out of John chapter 19. And I want you to wrestle with this choice of, will I choose my King again this morning? Maybe there's an area of your life where in suffering you need to submit to and embrace him again, even in that suffering. The maze of your life is turning. You want to step off the tracks, but you this morning would submit to your King who's a mighty, merciful, present father, brother, family member who loves you, who's made you his son or daughter. And maybe there's an area of your life where you're just making moral or ethical choices that are out of step with your King. Would you this morning say, I want to submit even that area of my life to you, my King? And maybe you've not submitted your workplace to your King. You're just living there. You're going to work and doing your thing and not even thinking of your King there. Or your marriage or your singleness or your kids. Would you present all these aspects to him, your King? He came to dethrone us for our good. In preparation for communion, just maybe even close your eyes and listen in prayer as you make these decisions this morning to make him King yet again, or make him King over that piece, even that piece of your life. A Pilate, the governor, the one who was, in a sense, king and authority of Judea, entered his headquarters again and called Jesus and said to him, are you the King of the Jews? And Jesus answered, do you say this of your own accord, or do others say it to you about me? And Pilate answered, am I a Jew? Your own nation and the chief priests have delivered you over to me. What have you done? And Jesus answered, my kingdom is not even of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting that I might not be delivered over to you and the Jews. But my kingdom is not from the world. Then Pilate said to him, so you are King? And Jesus answered, you say that I am King. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world, to bear witness to what is true. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my, Jesus' voice. And Pilate said to him, ah, what is truth anyway? After he had said this, he went back outside of the Jews and told them, I find no guilt in Jesus, but you have a custom that I would release one man to you at the Passover. So do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews? And they cried out again, not this man, but Barabbas. Now Barabbas was a robber. Then Pilate took Jesus and flogged him, and the soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on Jesus' head and arrayed him in a purple, which is royal robe. They came up to Jesus saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and struck him with their hands. Pilate went out again and said to them, "See, I'm bringing Jesus out to you that you may know I find no guilt in him." So Jesus came out wearing his crown of thorns, his purple royal robe, and Pilate said to them, "Behold this man." Then the chief priests and the officers saw Jesus. They cried out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourself and crucify him. I find no guilt in him." The Jews answered, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he had made himself the Son of God." When Pilate heard this statement, he was even now more afraid. He entered his headquarters again and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate said to Jesus, "You will not speak to me? Do you not know that I have authority to release you, authority to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no authority over me at all unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, the one who delivered me over to you has a greater sin." From then on, Pilate sought to release Jesus, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you're not Caesar's friend. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar." So when Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and sat down on the judgment seat at a place called the Stone Pavement and in Aramaic, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about the sixth hour, and he said to the Jews there, "Behold your king." They cried out, "Away with Jesus! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." So he delivered Jesus over to them to be crucified. Father, we come before you now, and each of us in our different ways. God, would you draw each of us that we would choose you as king, your son as king. That we would build our lives on him, the chief cornerstone. Knowing, God, that your might either will be for us in Christ or against us in judgment. Knowing, God, that your mercy has been shown to us in Christ, not based on anything we could do or not do. And you offer us freely your mercy, even now. God, change our prideful hearts. Change our haughty minds. Help us to trust in you. You've given us such reason in your Son. If you're not yet trusting in Christ, don't take communion, but would you receive Christ this morning? Or at least ask him to draw close to you and show himself to you. If you are trusting in Christ, would you rejoice, enjoy your Savior, submit your life more to him, and take communion when you're ready.